My name is Phil Ginsberg, and I have the pleasure and the privilege to attempt to pose useful questions and see if I can be efficient with the panel members. When you're asked questions, I'm going to ask you to be relatively brief in your answers because we have lots of good questions, and maybe we'll field some from the audience as well. But the first thing I want to do is to introduce a friend, and we jokingly call each other our own mentors. Aneelah Afzali is a distinguished lawyer and a faith advocate. Is that the proper term?
That works.
Good, good. And I had the good fortune to meet her several years ago as we were in the same law firm. And one day we found ourselves marching around the courthouse when there had been the arrest of a number of judges from India, I believe. And I was pleased to learn so much from her. She's a graduate of Harvard, a partner at the Stokes law firm. And after a spiritual awakening, Aneelah decided to take a break from her successful legal career to pursue two things. Her faith emphasizes seeking knowledge and serving others. She currently serves as an interfaith advocate, community educator, motivational speaker, and aspiring author. She seeks to build bridges of alliance, organize interfaith events and service activities, increase and promote a real understanding of Islam, fight bigotry and hatred, and counter Islamophobia in our country with facts over fiction, courage over fear, love over hate. I think those are inherent in the Quran.
Absolutely.
And Aneelah, since you've done so much work in the overall community, I would like to ask you one question at the outset, and I urge the other panel members to join in as well. How can the average American non-Muslim meet Muslims? The Pew study a few years ago said that only 35% of Americans, non-Muslims, have ever met a Muslim. I invite all of you to do that, but I'll like to start with you if that's okay.
Thank you, Phil, for that very kind introduction as well. I'm honored to be here with everybody, so thank you to all of you for being here. And in response to the question, I think the first thing is to attend events like this. So the fact that all of you are here today, you're already taking that step to get to know Muslims, to get to meet Muslims, and hopefully have those connections that you're making at events like this ripen into true friendships. That is the hope and goal. Phil, as you recognize, so few people in our country personally know a Muslim. And when that's the case, it's very easy to dehumanize a people that you don't know. And we see a lot of that happening in our country. The exclusion and other comments that Mahmood Khadeer made as well earlier this morning, we are seeing that happening, and it's because of the lack of personal connections. So the more you actually connect with people, and not only the people like you who all hopefully have all met Muslims, you know, you can do it at events like this, you can do it at visiting mosques, that's something we highly encourage. You can do it at sharing a meal together, having interfaith dinners. We have had an interfaith dialogue series, and there are a number of other events where you can connect and meet Muslims. But then the important thing is to not stop there, to develop the friendships, but beyond that, share your personal connections and the stories that you have of those personal connections with the wider audience. Because unfortunately, given our 1% or so in terms of population in this country, there's not enough Muslims for every single American to be able to meet, unless that's all we do, right? If that's our full-time job, we could do it. But we often have other things to do too. So for that reason, we really rely on our allies, all of you, to be the voices who are able to then share your personal connections, stories about your personal friendships with the Muslims you know, with the rest of the world as well. And that's how we humanize at a larger level. That's a quick answer if anybody else wants to weigh in.
Yes, I'd encourage each of you to give us your thoughts on that.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so I definitely agree with everything Aneelah said. Interfaith has actually done a lot in terms of opening up these conversations, getting into questions that we might have in the backs of our minds that we might not feel comfortable asking, the person that we see on the street or our neighbor. for instance. But that's not to say that we can't have any conversations with our neighbors or the person on the street. I think that you don't have to go very far to be able to find a Muslim. Even though there's only, we're only like 1% of the US population, you can still find Muslims that are around you. I mean, I think I gave some of the numbers. You know, 50,000 doctors are Muslim. That's 1 in 18 doctors. Chances are someone in this room has a Muslim doctor. You know, chances are that there's a doctor, Muslim doctor, at the clinic that you go to. You know, so, but, and I'm sure that many in here also have children or have been part of PTAs at some point in their lives. And, you know, there are Muslims that are in PTAs. There's Muslims that in our children's schools, you know, that are peers to our children that, you know, maybe we see around the school, but we don't ever interact with them. Or, you know, we assume that maybe our children will interact with them and, you know, that job is done, or you see them and that's good enough. But really, reaching out to the folks that are around us makes a huge difference. And I can tell you, like, my mother, for example, I have two little sisters. One of them is in middle school. She just started middle school for the first year. And the other one is in her last year of elementary school. And, you know, in the school that we've been in for all these years, my mother would say that, you know, there wasn't much interaction that she had with many of the mothers in the PTA that she would be in. You know, she'd reach out. She'd, you know, make sure that she lets people know who she is and who her children, who my sisters were. But there was very little interaction that would happen. It was, you know, there might be a hello or there might not be a hello. You know, there might be some acknowledgement, there might not be. Very few relationships were formed over the years. And that creates a sense of, you know, alienation in your own community, as well as, you know, not building that strong connection and knowing that you have neighbors that are there as a Muslim, you know, not knowing that your neighbors are there to be able to help you if there is ever a time in need. And on the other hand, you know, there's a lack of education that happens. There's an opportunity for education that's being missed out on. So that's just one example of ways that, you know, you can reach out to those that are already around you.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I think those were the great points that's made by Aneelah and Varisha. I think the way I want to look at this is, when you say you want to meet a Muslim, you're actually having, you know, kind of some thoughts, some things that you want to connect with. So if we remove the, you know, like I talked in my speech about the build the trust and build the suspicion, build the trust with the Muslims and you know, kind of look around in that particular area, then there are many opportunities, right? We are like, you know, even though we are 1%, you can find, you know, in grocery stores, you can find in any other places, you can reach out to the centers, you can participate in the events like the people have said here. And if you have a specific questions about what Islam is, what you really wanted to see, then centers like MAPS that we have, we encourage people to reach out to them through their mailing list. And even last week, somebody was reaching out to me saying they're doing research on the Islamic studies in a non-Muslim person. She wants her to observe our Friday prayer. So we immediately arranged within 2 days for her to visit our center and do that. So it is both ways. And one thing I want to say is sometimes, you know, we have to look at the human nature. Sometimes you will have people who may not be willing to connect a little bit, and so you have to accept the diversity in the thoughts of the people, and then make sure that you know, you can attempt to reach out to them. And I think more than usual, you will find you know, more information that will be provided to you.
Let me follow up just for a second on that. Are there other imams or members of mosques in the audience who would encourage people to visit their respective mosque? Yeah. Could you raise your hands? Yeah. I think that's a terrific idea, and I visited MAPS a few times, well, several times, and I've always felt very welcome, not just to services, but to presentations of controversial discussions and
So let me add to this conversation. There are really two points I want to make. One is, what is it that we can do to make a connection with Muslims? I think, as I alluded to earlier, that in our secular society, we have a dogma against people of faith, and we don't make it comfortable for people to discuss faith in their workplaces or schools or whatever. So how can we I grew up in East Africa, in Tanzania. When I grew up in Tanzania, when we went to school, we had Hindus, Buddhists, Christians, Catholics and Protestants, and Methodists and Presbyterians, and different kind of things. We actually learned about this by attending, you know, by talking about faith at school. So when we grew up, we were in complete harmony with as young people, with each other's faiths. In our society, we don't have that comfortable way of discussing faith in the public square. That's why we said Islam in the public square. That's one point, which is really a point for all of us in society. How do we make it easy for people to share their faith in public square? But my second point is really targeted to the Muslim community. And in fact, I would actually target it to my own part of the Muslim community. For example, this is the time of Muharram. Muharram is the first Islamic month. In the first Islamic month, the Shia Muslims around the world commemorate the sacrifice of the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad, Imam Hussein al-Islam, who was martyred in the battlefield of Karbala. And the reason why he actually went through the martyrdom is because he said he set out to reform the community of his grandfather, the community of the Prophet. And he did so by inviting people to do good and forbidding evil. That was his mission. I set out to reform the community of my grandfather, to invite people to do good and to forbid evil. However, the Shia Muslims right now, today, are all congregated in their own private spaces on this movement, rather than engaging in events like this, right? So we need to actually look at our rituals as Muslims. You know, our rituals, do they have relevant context to the new place we find ourselves in? We need to reinvent ourselves, right? How do we reach out and share the commonality that we have, right? Our common humanity. I think Dr. Markuly talked about it earlier, about how we take our faith to the society at large. So the connection, making a connection with the Muslim, is not really a burden only on the non-Muslims, is equally a responsibility that we Muslims have in reaching out.
Any other suggestions?
Mine would be similar to Jawad's. I think I would approach it from a little bit different perspective. When I come to these kind of things, I really enjoy them a lot, but I sometimes feel like I'm singing with the choir. My guess is that most of you know someone of the Muslim tradition. You probably maybe even are a little friendly or are very friendly. There's a social psychological principle called that our brains are actually wired to handle about 150 fairly close relationships. And you get above 150 and you start blurring the details of who the person is and you can't remember their name, put it with their face and whatnot. From each of us have Dunbar units of relationships, and I mean, maybe part of the strategy is to have dinner parties bringing other people in your Dunbar unit who have not met someone of the Islamic faith into your network so that they can actually meet, they can meet somebody you trust and you have a relationship with. Their suspicions are gonna be lower by that mere fact, and then you can actually have a real conversation. I mean, probably for me, one of the best things I could do is to take Jawad with me to Fort Worth to meet my cousin I was talking about.
Well, you know, I think it's an interesting thing. I mean, let me relate to an example. We tend to talk to people who have similar views. The question, challenge is how do we have dialogue with people who may have different views? I want to share a story, right? Once, recently, I came in touch with Lila Cohen from the American Jewish Committee, right? And, you know, people have a problem with the issue in Israel and Palestine or whatever. And many Muslims would have a hard time sitting down with AJC people. Right? Now, you see, the thing is that, you know, I take it as a challenge, right? I don't really, you know, the fact that I sit down with Lila Cohen doesn't really mean that I agree with what AJC stands for, but I'm willing to sit down and discuss with a person who's got a different point of view. All of us have to find the courage to sit down with people who may have a different point of view.
Let me ask the audience, how many of you are in groups such as Rotary? I know there's at least one, the doctor who I was sitting with. Yes, thank you. And others. Okay. Once you have, particularly the non-Muslims, once you have formed an association, I encourage you to invite people to join your organizations and engage in common activity. The International District Rotary was formed in 1984, a fine Muslim man was part of that initial group, and through his good offices, Muslim men and women joined, and we engaged in lots of activities together. The same thing with your professions. If you're in some field of work where you could usefully invite someone from another faith, particularly the Muslim faith, to be part of you, that could help. Was there more in this panel that we didn't get to say?
You just inspired another thing we did in Seattle area, which is pretty good. I mean, after 9/11, you know, when 9/11 happened, Laura Capistani from the Sacred Heart Church approached us exactly on this topic, can we build homes together? So we reached out with our friends from Temple of Divina Torah, Cantor David is there. And together with St. Joseph Catholic and Bellevue Christian, five congregations, we came together. We were building homes for the needy in Seattle for 12 years, Habitat for Humanity. Exactly the point that Phil was mentioning. You know, it's really not about just preaching our faith, but it's really living our faith, right? We say we don't want any homeless people in our Seattle. The best way is to swing a hammer and put a roof when one doesn't exist.
Good. Well, thank you. I appreciate the suggestions there. One of the questions that the good people who put this fine program together suggested be asked, is it true young American Muslims are being radicalized? What is the cause of radicalization, and what is the response? And whoever is the bravest should go first.
Anybody can go somewhere.
Yeah. So I think the answer to that question is true. In some areas, they are getting radicalized because of the technologies that we have today, because of the connections, the way the radicalists are using the social medium and all the channels that are available to them for the bad of the society. So the answer to that is true. And then, but I think we have a lot of work to do within not only Muslim, but all the other communities of the young children to make sure that their basic questions are answered, their careers are discussed, they have a path forward to really be a part of the society. Many of us, many of our younger generations are not able to find avenues for good education, not able to find avenues for extending their careers, their opportunities to interact are limited. So we have to look at this as a holistic problem, because the kids that are grown here, they are not just, they were never attracted to that philosophy or everything, because we have our system here, they are growing up here. So there is apparently certain things that is attracting to them in that aspect of it. So as the communities of faith and even other communities, we have to look for it. We have to provide those avenues and those opportunities for our young children to get attracted to the peaceful societies. One of the things that we do at MAPS very effectively is, if you look at the construction, even when we are building that MAPS, we are very thoughtful about this, is we divided that into a prayer area and a gym area, which we open it up on Friday. The main reason for us to do that is, so our young kids, I mean, any faith you pick, if you go to a church, you will find very less attendance from the young kids, right? It's all, so how do we bring them? So we have to bring them to be the events which connects with them, so that we can understand what problems that they are facing, address them, so we can protect them from getting radicalized.
I'll give an answer too. So I wouldn't look at this question as American Muslim youth specifically. I think our people in our country and around the world perhaps, but let's focus on our country, people are getting radicalized, just in general. You look at sort of what's going on with this election. It's not specific to the Muslim community. People are feeling disenfranchised. People are feeling disconnected. People are feeling, the spiritual void, and when they have those kinds of disconnection to anything, to society in general, then that is the opportunity for gangs or for other cults to attract them. So it's a problem that we're seeing around our country, particularly with economic crises or political situations and foreign policy or things like that. These are ways to incite people or to get them to consider sort of other opportunities or ways, but they really are looking for ways to feel important. If you look at actual stats of people who engage in mass shootings, you have a lot of people who are oftentimes, the media describes the ones who are non-Muslim as lone wolves. And there's a reason for that. All of them are. They're disconnected from society. There are people who don't have a place that they feel connected or at home. And this is why it's super important to have mosques play the important role in society that they do, just like churches or synagogues and temples, is we need to get people connected, especially the youth. They need to feel like they have some self-worth, that they have something valuable to contribute and to gain from society. And the further we isolate people, Muslims or non-Muslim, the further we isolate people, the more likely they are to fall victim to these kinds of manipulations, to these cults, to these gangs, or anything else like that in this country or abroad. So the same is true regardless of what kind of youth we're talking about, but we need to be supporting mosques and supporting mosques that do the kind of work that MAPS in Redmond does, which is bring people together and give them a true understanding of religion, you know, whether it's Islam, whether it's Christianity, whether it's Judaism. We need that true understanding, and then we also need ways for people to feel like they're involved in something, that their life matters.
Sure, sure. I was gonna say, as a young person, you know, we're talking about youth, Muslims believe that God favors the peaceful. You know, Muslims condemn all violent acts and uphold the Constitution and laws of the United States. And American Muslims give back to society every single day. And as I mentioned earlier in my speech, and it's important to remember that 10,000 American Muslims served in our armed forces, and many have made the ultimate sacrifice for this country. You know, American Muslims do uphold the Constitution and values of the United States, and that's, you know, who you're looking at. That's who your neighbors are. That's who, you know, young Muslims are. And as a young Muslim, that's what I believe in. And overall, I think, you know, when we're talking about, you know, how, you know, what is a trend? What are we doing? You know, if this is an overwhelming majority of our community, of our neighbors, of our American Muslim population. And, you know, when it comes to, you know, fringe communities, you know, that's where we talk about, well, what's inside the community. That tends to come up a lot, is what's happening inside. Are you serving your own community? Are you giving back? Are you teaching the right and wrong? And ultimately, it, you know, if we talk about mosques, you know, what happens in a mosque? Who's going? What's being taught? Well, a study that was done by Harvard, it was a Harvard study that was done, that shows that the more a Muslim is engaged in a mosque and attends mosque services, mosque activities, and is engaged in the Muslim community, the more likely they are to be civically engaged, the more likely they are to vote, the more likely they are to give back civically. So overwhelmingly, that's who the population is. You know, this is a community, this is who we are, ultimately. We can't forget that at the end of the day.
Let me just interject. Every time I visited MAPS, in addition to being obviously a religious institution, it seems to be a place where people are educated on how to be good Americans. And I analogize that to a group that in the 1930s and 40s and 50s, a Jewish group called B'nai B'rith, did the same thing with its recent Jewish immigrants. I interrupted, so who wants to go next?
Yeah, I mean,
so
the question was, are young Muslims being radicalized, right? So clearly, let's actually look at facts, right? San Antonio, right? San Bernardino, or Orlando, right? Clearly was an example of people who actually did something and what they think, you know, as Muslims. Now, the question really is, that was a failure at the individual level, right? It happened. Why did it happen? It was a failure at the family level. It was a failure at a community level. But I think it was also at a failure as a national level. I mean, how can we Americans look ourselves in the eye when say the narrative of ISIS is more attractive to them than what the best, the most powerful country America has to offer to them, right? We have to have the courage to face in the mirror. The American narrative should be far more compelling than the deadly ISIS narrative. Why is it that this individual being attracted to an ISIS narrative? Right? That's the question we have to ask. Right? So it's not, I mean, I think Aneelah talked about it, you know, anybody can get radicalized. That's the one part. The other part I would say is that if you look at Anwar Araki, right, the guy who was in Yemen and who was a preacher in the United States, and he actually, even his videos are being used even till today to attract these things. This person was a United States citizen, and he's actually, even though he has been taken out, he continues to do damage. The question is, we have to be careful in guarding our mosques from radicalization. This is an example, it actually happened, right? We have to be careful. Now, what is the solution to that? The solution to that, we have to invest in religious institutions or seminaries that are actually going to create indigenous people who will come and serve our community as imams, as chaplains, and so forth. This is a long-term thing. This is a discussion Mark and I have had many times. We've visited Harvard and other Yale and Harvard Seminary. This is an investment we have to make so that basically the preachers and the ministers for the Muslim community should have a connection with the local culture, right? Are able to lead, and we don't have the exposure like we had with Anwar Araki. It's a factual thing that's going on. The third thing I'd like to say is that, look, you know, civil societies cannot really entice people with slogans of death. I mean, one thing, for example, I get inspired by when I watch Francis, right? He goes out there and washes the feet of these refugees, right? Imagine if Prof. Francis said, you know, Christians are being killed in Nigeria, and Christians are being killed in Pakistan, and Christians are being killed here, and, you know, we must defend Christian interests. What'll happen? Mayhem, right? He doesn't do that. Instead, he goes out there, there are brothers and sisters, I wash their feet. So I call upon all in the Muslim world, stop slogans of death, right? You know, people who are in leadership positions in countries, when after the calls of prayer, they say death to America, death to Britain, death to Israel, death to oppose this, there's no room for that. And we as civilized societies should stop, because who knows, the triggering act for Bernardino guy was brainwashed, right? And so death to this, and one day he picks up and does that, right? Now, it may be, when I say this, I'm sure there are people in the Muslim community, because last time I spoke out publicly like this, there's an article in Seattle Times, I got a lot of criticism of the Muslim community. That why are you doing this? This is the fact, not on my watch. I don't really want to pass my life with slogans of death. I want slogans of progress and civilization. So this issue is not, again, a responsibility only one part of the thing. All of us together, Muslims and non-Muslims, have to work on our narrative, on making sure that the people who are there are responsible, and making sure the messages from the top are one of reconciliation, progress, and advancement, not death and destruction.
Thank you.
I can make a follow-up comment on that, actually.
Very good.
Very briefly.
Yes.
Just to comment on, you know, scholars, and as you talk, you call for, you know, Islamic leadership to, you know, to condemn and to unify, and I think oftentimes whenever, you know, we see stories, you know, news stories with another headline of some shooting, something that happened, and there's a Muslim involved in, as a perpetrator, you know, immediately, if you watch, you know, CNN or, you know, Fox News or whatever, you'll find that, you know, Muslim leaders across the country will come out and condemn. I mean, Council on American-Islamic Relations, CAIR, that's the first thing that they do. You know, we might hear, Jawad is going to be the first one out there to say that, you know, we condemn this act of terrorism. And that's because American Muslims do condemn all acts of violence and criminal acts. And, you know, on a global scale, you know, that's the U.S., on a global scale, I don't know if you might recall, but there was a letter that was written by scholars at the highest levels across the world, you know, but in the U.S. and, you know, Muslim countries and non-Muslim countries as well, hundreds of scholars. I believe the number was, oh gosh, I can't remember the number. It was like 800 or something like
common
that.
Common word.
Sorry?
The common word.
Common word.
Yes, and that they basically came together to write out a 500-page document condemning ISIS and the leader of ISIS, and that was to create a global presence of condemnation against this small fringe group that represents zero, it's like 0.001% of the population of the global Muslim community. So that leadership is doing that work, that leadership is reaching out, they are speaking out. It's a matter of, are we listening?
One of the things you said this morning had to do with how the media depict the Muslim community. And many of you may remember the upstate New York man who founded a yogurt company, and he then decided to give the shares to his employees. What was lacking from that article was the reference to his being a Muslim, and it's something that we should try to maybe encourage our journalist friends to do, and maybe you'll be able to do that in your work. It's important to talk about the important good things and the many contributions that so many scientists and musicians and actors and athletes make in this country. Yes?
Yeah, I'm in no way prepared to answer the question as posed. however, you know, if I could pivot it just a little bit, when you're talking about youth and their alienation, that's a common problem for all of us. And I think a lot of it goes back to our congregations, to how welcoming are they to young people. I know one of the great sins that Christian congregations have a tendency to do is they treat, if they're welcoming at all to young people, they treat them as the future church, not the current. They don't really know how to interface. And I think when you look at the fault lines of the particularly between generation, so-called Generation X and the millennial generations, you're seeing such profound cultural shifts and dynamics that are leaving, they're swallowing young people in kind of anomie and a sense of complete dislocation. When Pew does their annual study on religious affiliation, the second largest denomination right now is the nuns. And we here in this part of the United States are ground zero for the nation, for the nuns. Most of the times that happens. That's not by accident. You know, our congregational structures are just not conducive to meet young people where they're at. And so they're all in danger of being radicalized or lost, you know, to all kinds of things. So,
thank you. Another question suggested by our organizers has to do with the role of women, and I'm sure you all recall the comments made about Mrs. Khan, the mother of the soldier who died, the Muslim soldier who died in combat, and there were some critical things said about her gratuitously. So the question I have is, how does the Quran define the role of women? How is that role different depending on the culture they live in? And I think we'll start with either of you.
Yes. Let's go with both of the women.
Yeah. Paper, scissors.
So this is a great question, and we get it obviously all the time because there is, again, the negative stereotypes about Muslim women. I will say both of us here are perfect examples of everyday American Muslim women in our country. I hope you get the sense that we're articulate, intelligent, and that we are proud and strong-willed and happy and excited about sort of our Muslim identity as well as our American identity.
And respected,
thank you. We hope, right? We won't say that part, but no, seriously, Islam grants women rights. It has given the package of rights that Islam brought 1,400 years ago are rights that in this country even 200 years ago we didn't have. So this is sort of the misunderstanding about women's rights and Islam is profound. Islam gives rights to women, you know, the right to divorce, the right to choose who you want to marry, the right to own property. Even as a married person, you own your own property. The right to get money and get supported by whether your father or husband. The groom has to pay money to a bride as opposed to the other way in certain other cultures. I mean, there are so many rights. I have a long list, it's 2 pages long of bulleted points of different rights that Islam granted women. Having said that is Islam. We do have culture. Unfortunately, culture sometimes changes the perception of religion and the implementation of the rights that Islam itself grants. So you cannot do, like, women are entitled as a matter of right to education in Islam. You may not see this happening all the time in other places and other cultures. But if you look at America, American Muslim women are the second most highly educated religious community in our country. The wage gap between American Muslim men and American Muslim women is non-existent. And that's unique for sort of any religious community if you look at the numbers and the stats.
Do you have a leadership role in your mosque?
I've been on the Interfaith and Outreach Committee of our mosque. We're talking about some other ones as well.
Yeah. So, I mean, just for in this specifically to address that, yes, we do have a leadership role in our center. We have, in fact, one minimum woman to be on our board. That is a requirement. So we want to make sure that the participation comes. That is only minimum. It could be a larger number of the women in the board that can be there. And I think, like Aneelah has said, I think we have to just separate out. Whenever you talk about the rights of the woman, we kind of associate what Islam teaches us. She has given good examples about what our religion is. But culturally, if you see, many countries, many different cultures have different ways in which that they interact with the women. But here, when in our country, in our communities, I think we are bounds ahead of how we engage with our women, how we have equal participation in many of the things that we do, and how we drive some of these conversations in our communities.
So on this point here, I would like to actually, I don't do this, and I'm going to do it right now. I'm going to, hopefully it doesn't backfire on me. I would like to actually have my wife, Khaneez, stand up. You know, she is not only that she is a board member, but the principal of the Sunday school, but she's the founder, co-founder of the Iman organization in Kirkland, right? I mean, without her contributions and sacrifices, I don't think Iman would exist, okay? And we actually started this in our home, actually, when we bring our kids. Thank you. I think people, we all should realize that women are our mothers, our wives, our sisters, right? And they are our nurturers. Muslims are, you know, taught to respect women. I mean, we are taught paradise is at your mother's feet, right? We cannot go to paradise. When somebody goes to Prophet Muhammad, says, hey, I would like to actually go serve the community, he says, go take care of your mother. He goes again, go take care of your mother. Again, go take care of your mother. And the fourth time, he says, now take care of your father, right? Emphasizing the importance of respecting and doing things for the mother. So I think that there's a very special place for women in society. I think that at the same time, I would say that there is also inequities. And, you know, I like to talk about myself in the sense that because, you know, rather than passing a judgment. I mean, if I look at my own family, you know, when I finished my high school, obviously it was obvious that you go to university, get a degree, and so forth, and my sister, no, you should get married and settle at home, right? That was not that far ago. It's 1970s I'm talking about, right? But that's not the case today. But because that was really, I was living in Tanzania, right? And that was the normal cultural norm for that stuff. Right, and even in Tanzania, things have moved on, right? Now, like what Aneelah talks about, right, it's really good to know that women in America, Muslim women in America, are not far behind men. That's really great to know. And I hope all of us in America can actually take pride on that there's no glass ceiling for women in America.
And I would just add, too, sorry, if you can get a chance to. I would just add, if you look around the world even, you know, we talk about culture, but if you look around the world, Muslim countries have had women heads of state or presidents or prime ministers. Maybe we'll get one this year, but I mean, this just gives you sort of the.
Be careful what you ask for.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, absolutely. So definitely, you know, if we look around the world, you know, Muslim women have been holding leadership positions longer than literally America has when it comes to our president. And you know that goes. That's not just a coincidence. That's not just because you know those countries are. Maybe doing something right. It's a matter of principle, and you know, by principle, you know, American Muslims in the U.S. you know uphold the Constitution, laws of the United States, and we believe that you know Muslims can practice their faith and uphold the Constitution and laws of the United States at the same time. And you know, as an American Muslim woman, I choose how to live my life. You know, I choose my religion. I choose whether or not to wear my headscarf, and this wearing a headscarf for me is my choice. And that is a choice that is given to me both by the laws of the United States that allows me freedom of religion, as well as my religion itself, which says that there is no compulsion in religion. In the Quran, it says there is no compulsion in religion. There's no one that can force you to do anything. That's up to you. You choose what you want to do or if you don't want to do it. If you want to abide by principles, go ahead. If not, you don't have to. Or no one's going to stop you. No one's going to make you. And that, you know, when we talk about, you know, equality, we talk about women, and we talked about this at our table earlier, you know, at the essence, the core of the beliefs of Islam is that men and women are equal, right? The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him's teaching is that women, both women and men, should pursue high levels of education and give back to society. That's why I'm at the University of Washington right now, so because of my teachings that my parents taught me of the Prophet Muhammad.
You know, I think I'm glad you brought up the issue of headscarf, because I think one of the things I've encountered in my interfaith discussions around the things, you know, why do women have to wear a headscarf, right? Now, you know, if you look at clothing, well, clearly there are two extremes. Nothing, society is not functional, right? And completely covered, individuals not functional, right? So those two extremes don't work. You have to find a middle. And the Muslims have actually decided that actually this is what it is. So what I'm amazed about is why there is no discussion in our society about women wearing less and paying more for what the little they wear.
One comment. There's been a few references now to the Muslim faith and its consistency with the U.S. Constitution. And St. Mark sponsored a fine two-day conference in 2011, in which the featured speaker was the imam from New York, the so-called Ground Zero imam. And he has a book that I read comparing the Quran to the Constitution and the very close similarities. So since you have brought that up, I felt it would be useful to refer to that. The next question is compound and complex, and was also given to me by our planners. And essentially, it's going to ask each of you to tell us the difference between Sunni and Shia faiths and where Wahhabism fits in, and as to both or all three of those components, is it applied, is Sharia law relevant, and is it applied differently by Sunni and Shia? Compound, complex, we could spend the rest of the day talking about it.
That's four questions.
But I have to blame my mentors here. No, it's an important question, and to be sure we get all views, I may at some point interrupt you if I think you're
okay. So okay. First of all, you know, set up. This is my Sunni brother. I love it. I think the Sunni Shia is not getting along. I mean, with me and Mahmood, it's not a question of admiring. It's a question of love. I love him for him being a human being, and the fact that I love him as a human being. Not that I don't see the Sunni in him or the Muslim in him. I see him as a human being, right? And that's really what is a relationship, and our relationship is based on love. The Shia-Sunni thing is really a theological difference. The theological difference is very simple. Shias believe that there was divinely appointed imams after the Prophet. The Sunnis don't believe that, right? But that's a theological difference. Everything else about that is really politics. Politics actually have taken place in different countries in the Middle East, and I don't even want to go into this national politics of the countries, because whatever you spin it, I may be biased, other people may view it negatively. But the thing is, suffice to say that there are geopolitical interests that are guiding the policies of those countries that are driving the sectarian divide, right? It's a divide and conquer, and we cannot fall prey to that, right? Just like that we will not fall prey to the division in Ireland between Protestants and Catholics. Right, because you know, I don't know of a Catholic or a Protestant who doesn't wish well for humanity, right? And the conflict in Ireland is just like that. That's what it is. I think there is something to be said, right, for extremist ideas coming in and from funding that sources. We gotta be careful that those extreme radical things are not funded. And you know, our government is more than capable of controlling that stuff, right? And you know, so that's something. You know, there's actually action taken right now after this 9/11 commission. Was that we had to take these families who supported the 9/11 terrorists to task. I think that's good, and we should have the rule of law take its full course, and those who are guilty should be taken to justice about this stuff, right? Now, because there are some radical ideologies that are actually driving this extremism, right? And I talked about earlier that it's important that we have leaders, preachers, who are grounded in our context rather than actually some weird stuff which is driven politically to drive an agenda. I mean, those are two points. What was the third point?
Well, as the good lawyer that she is, Aneelah told me that I was asking a compound complex question. But is there a difference with respect to the observance of Sharia law, however you want to define it, between Sunni and Shia?
Well, I mean, I think the Sharia law is, again, a very, very confused topic in our society in America, right? What is Sharia law? Sharia law is about protecting faith, about property, protecting dignity, faith, and all this. That's what it is, right? I mean, I think in the Jewish community, for example, you have similar things. I'll give you an example. Let me give you an example in our society here. What happens is that a husband and wife would be married. They might go to a court and get divorced. The husband will not pronounce the Islamic divorce. He is allowed to marry up to four women, so he can go and marry another wife. The woman is trapped, he cannot marry again, right? That's because there's a difference between the secular law and the Islamic law that's there, right? So I think there's not really that, I don't see many differences between the legal situation between Shias and Sunnis, When it comes to law. I mean, you know, I think that, you know, stealing is bad, you know, lying is bad, gossiping is bad, all the universalism is there. I think you'll find a lot of common things, even with Christianity and Judaism, for that matter, right? We pray 5 times a day. We fast in the month of Ramadan. We have the same Quran. We pray, worship in the direction of Kaaba, right? Sometimes people may pray with hands folded, and some people may do that. So Sunnis may also do open this way. Those differences are minor. When it comes to principles, there is really not that much difference, is what I understand.
So, Jawad has covered most of it, and I think you have seen, to address the question on theological side, he covered perfectly, like what the difference between Shia and Sunni is. But I really wanted to focus on commonalities. I think that is where we, moving forward, have to kind of think about it, because if you look at Islam, Islam is a way of life, and it's a total religion. Spirituality is a part of this, but there is a lot of actions that you have to do in a society that we live in. And if you look at that pie, if you look at that in the form of a pie, you know, maybe 25% is spiritual, 75% is a regular human being, how we live, how we interact, and how we do. And I have been with Jawad, I have been with many of my Shia friends. We never ever had, like today you saw, I called the call for the prayer. Jawad led the prayer, we prayed together. The differences are being created, like I said in my speech, to create this doubt and confusion in the common people for their own advantages, right? So from Sharia perspective, you're saying Sharia is the interpretation of your teachings from the religious perspective, obeying the law of the country that you're living in. So United States Constitution has to be abided by the Muslims. So if you look at Sharia implementation and understanding, always you will find differences in people trying to interpret one over the other, looking at the situation. So for us, as the communities of faith, the communities of concern for the human beings, we should really focus on looking at these commonalities and see how we can enrich and enforce each other. Because these questions, we are going to see and we are going to get, but how do we answer that and divide? I may not agree with this or that. Or we say, look, let's just go together and try to take these communities of faith forward. Because there are differences between Christians, Muslims, and every one of a human being, we have different kind of differences. Similarly, I will look at the Wahhabism that you were asking about. So that is, again, a very stricter, kind of interpretation that is going on in one part of the world. I think we have to look at what really Quran and our teachings of our Prophet teaches us and how we can apply them in the society that we live in, adhering to those basic principles. That's why in our center in MAPS, we are very particular about how do we apply those for the upliftment of individuals, community, and the society that we live in. So I think that's how I will look at it.
And I will just add briefly, because we've had this discussion.
You don't have to be brief. I appreciate the other two speakers being succinct, and I don't think we should cut either one of you
or the dean down there
off, yes. Yeah.
Thank you, Phil. So we had this discussion at our table, too, and what I said there is on the Sunni-Shiite split, it's a recent phenomenon that has been politicized, very much so, as you heard Jawad and Mahmood talk about, because for thousands of years, for the last 1,000-plus years before this sort of raised as a political issue, Sunnis and Shiites were coexisting, they were intermarrying, they were praying together, they were living together, they were sharing meals, all of this was happening. It's a minor theological difference, but that's not a basis for the kind of division that you see. What's happening in there, sort of in other countries, it's very much for geopolitical reasons. So keep that in mind. That's an important point. And then with respect to Sharia, what I really want to say, because there is this, again, this misconception around Sharia around our country. Not so much here, but certainly in other parts of the country where people have even tried to ban Sharia, to try to pass laws to ban Sharia. We've seen this happen and even be successful in certain places, unfortunately. And the reality is that Sharia is just Islamic teaching. So my ability to pray 5 times a day, that my direction, my command to pray 5 times a day, or to be good to my parents and serve my parents, or to contribute positively to society, to be a person who adheres to the Constitution and the laws of America, those are all what Sharia teaches. So banning Sharia really is banning religion for Muslims. That's what you are essentially doing, and that contradicts our American principles, our shared American principles, our Constitution, our rights of religious freedom. So it really is an attack directly on Muslims and Islam. It's not an attack on a, you know, a tiny criminal component of Islamic law, as some of the anti-Muslim people try to present it as. So Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said that he was not sent except to perfect character. And that's really what Sharia teaches us, is how to be the best people we can be and contribute positively to everything we touch and everything we do in this country and around the world.
Please.
Yeah, I was going to have a comment, but I don't know how to follow that. I think Aneelah pretty much said it all, but I think ultimately, yeah, because there's that big scary SH word, and that's Sharia. And ultimately, it is exactly what Aneelah said, which is its definition is Islamic teachings. It means path in Arabic, or literally it's Islamic teachings. And I think there's this idea that Sharia is like this code of law, this like book that like every single Muslim has and like in like their library at home, and they're going to use this one day, all of a sudden open it up and just overthrow the courts, and this is going to be the law of the United States. That's not even real. That's not a reality. That's not what Sharia is. That's not a book. And it's not coming to take over America at any point in time. Because each of us grapples with what Sharia is ourselves. Because Sharia simply just means Islamic teachings. Just means how we practice our religion. And, you know, yes, it does have a legal system, just as every religion has, in terms of, you know, what is acceptable, what's not acceptable in the faith. You know, like what's considered halal or haram in Arabic. And even, yes, there's a code of, you know, civil law, and there's a code of criminal law. It's a, like, if you were to really make it into a legal system, it could become a functioning legal system that's pretty thorough. But that legal system cannot be applied where we live today, because it takes the precedence of, you know, under an Islamic rulership, which, according to Islamic studies and Islamic scholars, that type of rulership doesn't even exist anymore. You know, nation states do not count as Islamic, you know, governance, really. It's really a matter of, like, you know, when we ended our caliphates 100 years ago, the last caliphate, which was 100 years ago in the Ottoman Empire, that was the last time we could have any sort of, you know, Islamic rulings, that any Islamic principles that we follow can be enforced. So when we talked earlier, when I mentioned earlier that there's no compulsion in religion, this is what we mean, is that there's no way to force or enforce that, you know, in the societies that we live in today, where if I choose to wear a headscarf or not, or if I choose to eat halal food or not, like, that cannot be enforced necessarily. But it really is just what I believe. It's how I pray. It's going to be how often I pray, what I consider to be acceptable food to eat, how I dress. That's Sharia. And unless you're afraid of Muslims, there's no reason to be afraid of Sharia.
And Mark, I wanted to ask you, from a comparative religion
perspective, all of our religions are divided based as much or more on cultural issues, political issues. You know, I think in this particular situation, the best book that I've read, really, is from an Islamic scholar who kind of comes at Islam the way I do, not from within the tradition. I had to look it up to get the full text on it, but it's a fellow by the name of Raymond Baker, and he wrote a book called One Islam, Many Muslim Worlds, and the subtitle is Spirituality, Identity, and Resistance Across Islamic Lands. And I think for me, it was very helpful, because it kind of wove a lot of these issues together in a kind of a succinct way that you can kind of grasp fairly easily.
Thank you. One question that arose during the presentations, on the progress from suspicion to annihilation, everybody catch that, on this sort of curve progression from suspicion to annihilation, I'd like each of you to tell us where we stand now.
So today we are, I'm used to answering the question directly, so just bear with me. So today, what I think is we are going more and more towards the suspicion, because of the lack of understanding and lack of interaction, lack of rhetoric the lot of rhetoric that the people are seeing around, etc. So we are on that particular spectrum on the suspicion phase. If you look at the majority of our country, especially as it relates to the Muslims, I think this is a very dangerous phase we are in. if we don't counter it, that's the reason of my talk was, if we don't address it, if we don't counter it, it really doesn't matter it is with Muslims. As you are seeing, it was, I mean, in the current political environment, you know, Muslims came, the description about banning Muslims came much later than, you know, talking about Mexicans, talking about other people in the political spectrum. So in that spectrum, I feel that we are in that particular era of suspicion, that we have to remove it and we have to start building trust with each other.
Next, please.
Okay, so I think we're actually further along, unfortunately, than the just the suspicion. I think your next step was exclusion, then dehumanization. I actually think in certain parts of our country, we are certainly at the dehumanization already. How many of you in here have heard of the Bureau of American Islamic Relations? Not the council, but the Bureau of American Islamic Relations.
There?
Yeah, bear. There's a few people who have.
Like
this is
CAIR.
An actual, exactly. So it's supposed to be a sort of a mock of CAIR, the Council on American Islamic Relations. And it's an actually very advanced militia. And they are preparing for war against Muslims and Islam in our country. Yeah, this is no joke. I mean, this is actually what's happening. They have a certain perception of Muslims and American Muslims, and they have weaponry. They are preparing. They're training regularly. They have their group ready, and they are ready to go to war. So we are certainly past just the suspicion phase, but it depends on which part of the country you're looking at. Because in a place like Seattle, you know, we're in a very different place than, fortunately, this bear, which is based in Texas, I believe. Your home state. So I think it depends on where you're looking at. And I think the reality is that if good people like all of us in this room stand up, we will be able to, you know, fight this trend that is moving in a certain direction. But if we happen to be lazy, if we happen to think, oh, this isn't going to get that bad, then it will get that bad. Because then we will have the same experience that people today, Jewish people in particular, can talk about what was going on in 1930s Germany. And they were seeing some of the same stuff here. Or Japanese Americans can talk about what was happening here in our country before the internment. So we're seeing a lot of those same kind of things. I tend to be an optimistic person, so I look at the hope and inspiration that I see around, and all of these good people standing together and coming together and saying, I'm not going to allow this to happen in our backyard or in our home or in our country. And that's what gives me hope.
Right. You know, one thing I want to add is that the European experience is very different than American experience. See, when you look at politicians in Europe, like David Cameron, he has said multiculturalism has failed. Multiculturalism is a fancy word for ghettos have failed, right? Of course, ghettos are destined to fail. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't have ghettos in America, but we dislike them, and we don't really encourage them. We actually fight them. We avoid ghettoization, and, you know, it's something we discourage the thing. There's integration and assimilation that takes place in our country here, right? And also, the melting pot metaphor is kind of outdated. You know, more like a salad bowl is much better, right, than the melting pot. But the thing is that, you know, we have to be careful about what kind of European concepts are imported in America. I mean, I think there's a lot of hate speech in some parts of Europe from politicians over there. They've got problems out of hand, for example, you know, in France and in Holland and other places. They have not really integrated, assimilated the populations that have been there. They've been living in the fringe. There's lots of things I've got. There's no time for us to go and ask me to be succinct. But the point I'm trying to make is that really we have to be careful as Americans. Our experience is different. We are a land of immigrants. We assimilate, we integrate everybody, we don't create ghettos.
Historically, the European countries made that big mistake of forcing segregated communities for Muslim communities, and fortunately here, that has not occurred, if at all, rarely. But let's continue, please.
Yeah, I just want to add, I mean, I think what everyone has said so far is pretty on point. Especially in terms of what Aneelah was saying about where we are right now in terms of, you know, we're beyond the suspicion phase. We're actually, I mean, we have a presidential candidate saying that he would like to ban Muslims from coming to the United States. So when my friends say, you know, I'm leaving, I'm going to Canada if he gets elected, I'm like, you know, if I leave, I can't come back. That's the reality. And the fact that a lot of people do agree with that or believe in that is problematic. And that's not just that language. It's not just that, you know, we can say, oh, that's probably not possible, or, you know, we're probably never going to, that's not going to become a reality. But what we talked about, you know, bare militant groups that exist in parts of the United States, you know, that are active, that are, you know, growing, that are actually, you know, talking about, you know, how do we expel or kill Muslims ourselves from, you know, our neighborhoods, that's absolutely dangerous. And it's beyond just those types of communities. It's beyond just those states that we see to be explicitly racist or explicitly Islamophobic, you know, Texas being one of them. We can, you know, definitely see what's impacting communities like in Seattle, right? And I mentioned hate crimes that took place in Washington State, which, you know, we pride on being a liberal state. So it's beyond just partisan issues. This is bipartisan, by all means. And the reality is that we actually have a multi-million dollar Islamophobia, like organization, or not organization, but it's a
network.
It's a field that, you know, makes millions on just fueling anti-Muslim hate speech in, you know, when it comes to PR in news, when it comes to political rhetoric, it gets all the way up there, down to like social media. I mean, the comments that you'll see on Facebook pages, on Facebook posts, it's not just, you know, individuals. It, a lot of it actually is pushed out through this Islamophobic, you know, anti-Muslim network. It's like a multi-million dollar industry. And that is having that impact where we actually see, there was a Pew, Washington Post, and ABC surveys that were done over the years. And post in 2001, October of 2001, the public's view of Islam was 40% positive and 30% negative. So again, it's less than 50% of America viewed Muslims and Islam positively. But given, you know, over the years, it's not that it's been significantly decreasing. Actually, even in the years following, in 2005, July 2005, that number was still steady at 40% positive and 30% viewed negatively. So it's not that 9/11 changed anything necessarily, but what we're seeing now is it's an unprecedented level of hate. And in 2014, that number actually just dipped from, like, between 2010, which it got down to 30% positive, and the negative number went up to 40%. Between 2010 and 2014, only 2 years ago, that number is now only 19% positive and 49% negative. And actually, 2016, I'm sure it's significantly worse now. So seeing this change, seeing these numbers decrease, that's showing that we're overwhelmingly reaching this, you know, we're beyond suspicion. It's nationwide. And we're getting to the point where we're really having to work against physical attacks on a large percentage of our U.S. population.
I'm going to ask the panel one more.
Mark wanted to say something.
I'm sorry.
Well, that's okay. I kind of have a split soul on this one. I started out as a social activist, and I moved into higher education. And, you know, we're often accused of living in the ivory tower, which we often do. If you come to one of our faculty meetings, you'll see how much we can live there. I think it depends on where you look and how you ask your questions, because, you know, there's a cognitive scientist at MIT, a guy named Steven Pinker, a number of years ago, wrote a book that got a lot of heat, because the name of the book was "The Better Angels of Our Nature: Why Violence Worldwide Is Declining," and people thought, you know, that's crazy, it's impossible. You know, we hear so much more about violence; it's obviously omnipresent, but actually, he was looking at metadata, and he was right. You know, I think with some of the statistics that we're amassing, as a social activist, they terrify me, and I'd want to be out on the street. As an academic, I guess there's another part of me that wants to dig down deeper into the information. And where I get hope with some of this data is, again, looking at the generational statistics, because those generational statistics oftentimes they kind of run counter to some of the larger data. So I'm like somewhere in between, but it depends on where you look.
You're taking a somewhat relativistic approach chronologically.
Yes.
But, I mean, I just one comment.
Please.
On, yeah, very short. I think, you know, it's good to know where we are in that particular spectrum. I mean, we may agree, disagree where it is, but I think we have to just see how we come out of that. How are we, whatever symptoms they are, maybe we are here, you know, people are suspicious or not. How do we build these bridges, and how do we take it forward as a society where we can lead it forward? So the point about that was to indicate, you know, different phases in which we go through, but independent of where we are in that particular spectrum, I feel that our country provides hope, opportunities for us, all of us, to really work towards it and, you know, overcome those hurdles.
I like that optimism to balance some of the data that you have also collectively shared. And One question, I'm not going to ask anybody to answer it now, but is there any way that this event and the learning process can be utilized on an ongoing basis, some kind of vehicle? And if you come across some ideas about that and want to share that with our organizers, please do. There's also sort of a democratic spirit here, and we have 15 minutes for the key questions that somehow we've neglected to ask the panelists that the people in the audience may have. If you want to ask a question, please put it in question form. Yes.
I'm a follower of World News, and you've already answered one question I have with respect to the European failure of multiculturalism, as it's being called. And certainly we've seen it in Germany, France, and England especially, where the fear seems to be this, that enough Muslims arrive and they tend to cluster in the same neighborhood, which is, you know, perfectly normal, I think, but they tend to want to become the political force for that particular neighborhood and then expand it into what some fear could become national.
And your question is?
My question is that have you heard that same message?
Thank you.
I mean, I think, in Europe, what's going on, what we discussed earlier, that, you know, this ghettoization has failed, right? The European also, the other issue in Europe you have got is the population growth of European, white Europeans is 1.6. At that rate of reproduction, you cannot sustain that population representation. So mix is going to change, right? And, you know, how is it going to change? You're going to have people from other countries, China, India, will actually have a large share of the people coming in. So the dynamics in the society are going to change. Right? And there's nothing that Europe can do right now. They should have done something long ago to actually have a production rate of 2.1 to be able to maintain the numbers, which they did not. Right? Now, obviously, if you actually have a mixed gender, even in the United States, we will be becoming a majority-minority country 20, 30 years from now. I think the point really here is inclusion. For example, I don't feel that I'm excluded in any part of society. My churches, you know, Marion Stewart from across the street from here, Toby was here from the city council. I, as an American, and people in my family and other, we feel we can do. I was at my company. I don't feel that I'm excluded from any part of society that prevents me from being in my ghetto, right? And the fact that I want to come out in the public square and share with you and have a candid discussion is a testimony to the openness of this society, that we can discuss these things candidly, which is very different than what happens in Europe, right? Mm-hmm. And that was the point I was trying to make earlier. The only way to prevent what you're talking about is to not really fall into the trap, the European trap, of creating ghettos. We don't want to create ghettos. We want to create open spaces where people can participate and air their views and work with issues, like things Mahmood was talking about. How do we engage in society, working together, building homes together? Phil was talking about Rotarians and so forth.
Good. Are there other panel members who want to respond to that question, or should we take the next question? Okay, we'll go to the young lady over here.
Thank you. First, thank you all for being here. Thank you for making it from 101 and beyond. It's really, one of those realities of people having to be educators, which I think can be exhausting and difficult, while also really important. So I want to acknowledge that while, you know, in forums, conferences, we can understand things cerebrally. We're intellectualizing things. But can you explain, even anecdotally, experientially, what's the emotion around being marginalized or being made the other? Or and for some people who can pass through different worlds, you know, and other people who, like when you were saying you went to the DNC, I had this visceral fear for you. And I don't know if you felt any of that. But anyway, I just think that part of the story gets missing in our humanization. But or in the dehumanization that's existing. But if you don't mind, sorry to make it so personal, but.
Well, absolutely. I say every individual has their own experience, and being from, you know, having the identity of being someone from a marginalized, you know, community, multiple marginalized communities, mind you. I mean, I believe in intersectionality. There's different identities that each of us carry. Being a Muslim woman, children of immigrants, you know, I'm, you know, South Asian of descent. And, you know, and wearing a headscarf, you know, that's my choice to wear as a Muslim woman to show my faith. And, you know, going every day, you know, growing up in America, I was born in Texas, like I said, it's, day-to-day is different, right? It's, you know, some days it depends on what's going on around you. You know, if I'm waking up to a headline that has a Muslim as a perpetrator, it's not going to be a pretty good day. And likely it's not going to be a good week or, you know, or month even for that matter, because what ends up happening is even though I did nothing, others around me don't know that I'm not the cause of this, you know, fear that's all of a sudden around me. And, you know, when you're in the classroom, you know, I like went to elementary school and middle school and high school here, and really every time the 9/11 would come up, or it was September 11th in school, you feel uncomfortable. You feel like even though I did nothing wrong, others around me expect me to kind of take that blame, or there's the eyes, there's the expectation of, you know, there's something that I have that's, you know, related to that. And that, you know, as a child has an impact where you do experience bullying, you do experience harassment in school. I've been called names because of my headscarf, because of my faith. I never let it stop me though, because I had to make sure that people knew who I was because of my faith. I don't want people to see me as something, as just a human being, just because of, you know, my accomplishments, but because my accomplishments are due to my faith. I do what I do because of my faith. I was the captain of my high school golf team. I wanted people to know that I'm athletic, and it's because my faith gives me that space to be that way. I went to the DNC. I wanted people to know that I'm there as a Muslim Washingtonian. I'm an elector for Washington State in this election. I want people to know that it's my faith that's driving me to do this.
Wrapping up.
Thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you very much. Does another panelist want to comment on that?
Very quickly. I mean, I would say that basically that the issue of this is really strengthens my resolve to live up to my patriotic duty to America, one nation under God, liberty for justice. Justice for all. That's really what it does to me. Given my experiences on airlines and at borders, and I don't want to go into too much details there. I can because there's no time.
Okay.
But it just strengthens my resolve to remind America of its greatness.
Yes. Thank you. Sir.
Yeah, thank you. It was good food for thought. Can you hear me? Okay, it was good for food for thought. However, I think the analysis was pretty shallow, or identifying what the problem is was very shallow, except a few books that Mark.
And your question, sir?
Well, we'll get to the question. I wanted to say just first of all, two things were put at fault here. One was the word radicalization, the other one suspicion. I don't think anybody here on the panel has really looked up what the word radical really means. Let me read it for you first. Radicalization.
Sir, I'm going to ask you to put your comment.
I will put the question.
I don't want to comment.
Okay,
I want a question because there's some other people.
Okay. Let me put a question. If you
got 30 seconds to pose.
Cut to that. Okay.
Sir.
So it's going to come to this, that are you going to address as a Muslim? All right? I'm questioning myself as a Muslim. Nobody here addressed the issue the Muslim community has Saudi Arabia. Even your organization, Council for American Islamic Relations, has condemned Syria and President Assad fighting a terrorist army attacking that nation. You have not once condemned Saudi Arabia.
Sir, what is your question?
I'm saying, when are you going to condemn Saudi Arabia?
All right. Thank you, sir. Next question, please.
Well, surprisingly, my question is sort of related.
Please put it in question form.
Yes. Well, it's back to the question of radicalization, and there's been reports about how one component of radicalization is inspiration from atrocities in U.S. Foreign policy and foreign wars in the Middle East. So, in other words, really bad things happen in Iraq that inspires, at least in part, an act of radicalization or that process. So putting that to the side, I'm just wondering, how do you feel about U.S. foreign policy in the Middle East, and do you feel free to criticize it here?
Yeah. So let me try to deal with this. You know, we have an addiction. It's a three-letter addiction. It's called OIL, hydrocarbons, okay? The thing is that we are, as the United States, we are very not in a comfortable position to do what we need to do to some parts of the Middle East where we need to take a brave, courageous position, right? I mean, like, you know, Saudi Arabia has funded a lot of madrasas around the world that are preaching these things. You can look at this evidence in Pakistan and other parts of the things. The positive thing that took place recently is that despite Obama's veto, United States Congress was able to override it and say, look, those people who funded nasty things for 9/11 will be taken to task. That's a very positive thing. And we will see through that process the scrutinization of what happened in Saudi Arabia, right? There's a lot of evidence. You can read about this stuff. Europeans are coming to grips with it. If you look at Vice Chancellor of Germany, he was on record about, you know, that Saudi Arabia must do to control the radicalization that's coming from there. So there's efforts that are taking place. I don't know what your question is, though, with regards to what, you know.
Oh, sorry, I don't know much about Saudi Arabia, I'll be totally honest, but I'm just thinking more about Iraq and the U.S. wars
I think what happened,
if you here as American Muslims feel free to criticize, is it okay for you to be open and criticize U.S. foreign policy?
I just express myself. We have an addiction to oil. It makes us, I'm going to think, our foreign policy. I mean, what are we doing in Bahrain, right? You know, we didn't do anything in Bahrain. You know, let's talk about Yemen, for example. Right now, United States is providing all these arms to Saudi Arabia and destroying innocent lives in Yemen. Now, in the same way that 9/11 families can bring a law case against United States for what against Saudi Arabia, well, I think Yemenis can also bring a case against the United States about what they are doing about supplying arms to Saudi Arabia, killing innocent people. So these are issues that will be dealt out in the things there.
Yeah. I'm originally from Afghanistan, and I will say certainly I have issues with American foreign policy in certain places. Iraq, we've had four presidents back-to-back bombing Iraq. So definitely I have my views on foreign policy, and I do feel free to express that. Having said that, I don't think two wrongs make a right. So I don't think any kind of justification of that, or any kind of foreign policy that we do justifies, you know, any kind of negative, violent response in that way. I personally am opposed to that. And that's why I think the majority of certainly American Muslims and Muslims worldwide would share that sentiment, that two wrongs don't make a right. And having said that, yes, I feel free to share and, be public and open about my views. And I think it's my patriotic duty as an American to be critical of my government's foreign policy, whether it's drone attacks, whether it's bombing, whatever it may be, to be critical and be engaged and actually do something to try to make a difference.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more question, if stated succinctly.
Very eloquently, but, you know, two wrongs don't make a right. My question is actually specifically, you know, in our mosques here, do we vet out the speakers we invite? And if we have a speaker that comes in and has other videos on the internet that may be insightful, should we be inviting that speaker to our mosque? This is a general question.
Okay. Let me address that. I think we actually, at least in MAPS, we have a committee who looks at our vision. Our vision is around four pillars: faith, inbound, outbound good, and model citizen. All the speakers that are
going to— Could you say that again more slowly, please? Okay. Those four criteria?
Yeah. So we have four pillars against which all the activities of MAPS are created under. Faith is one pillar, inbound good, outbound good, and model citizen. So when we get any speaker, when we get anybody to engage and provide a platform for them to speak, we make sure that their message is aligned with our vision and with our strategic pillars that we are driving at MAPS. Having said that, you know, it is very hard many times, you know, irrespective of whatever due diligence you do, sometimes, you know, they don't fill with the vision, they go more in a—
That's not my question.
Yeah.
My question is, suppose you bring in a speaker,
yeah,
and he's complying with the five or four,
yeah,
whatever pillars you have, and he's within those bounds,
yeah,
right? But he has a viral video on the internet saying you know, do this bad thing, this bad thing, this bad. So he set the right four or five pillars there, right, at your mosque. He was right on the money.
No,
he was vetted out. But he has, like, this video that millions of people see.
I agree with
His question is, do you do due diligence?
Do the vetting. We do the vetting and due diligence before we bring them.
Fine.
So you take responsibility for the person, not just his content there.
I cannot take responsibility for any person. What I do is, we do my due diligence.
If you put somebody on the podium, you're taking some...
I think what Mahmood is saying, which is like what any other mosque does. I mean, if there's a suggestion of a speaker, the person is vetted by a programs committee, and if there are any red flags, the person is not invited. If he passes the test,
so it's possible
he does. Now, it's possible that the guy may make a mistake, but that there's a policy not to allow nasty people.
Yes. I'm going to have to interject. If you can state your question, it's the last one, concisely.
My question is very generalized here, because what we are here is for American Muslims, being American Muslims. I know the Prophet has said that each Muslims are like a body. If any part of the body hurt, you should hurt. And that's a very renowned hadith. But anyways, my question is, like, we have multiple organizations of Muslims in the United States. ISNA is there, UMMA is there, MC, you name it, CAIR itself. What are you guys doing to combine all Muslims in one platform? That's the main thing. Means we, being an American Muslim, we should be combined and sitting together. There are sectarian issues, there are political issues, there are multiple issues. Every organization working on a different direction. What we are doing, and that's came to the same part which the lady asked the question, what American Muslim stance on the international issues? Because every organization has a different stance. We don't combine them in the right direction and address it to our government to push pressure on certain foreign policies. So this is the main thing. We have to combine and give one direction.
Thank you. Before you answer the question, could you restate it as you understand it?
Basically what he's saying, there's so many organizations in the United States, what are we doing to actually unite the things? See, I think on unity, you know, unity doesn't really mean uniformity, right? Unity does not mean uniformity. For example, when we put this event together, I think it started with Mary contacted me, and before long, we got all the series of people, Catholic, Church, the Episcopalians, the Lutherans, the Unitarians, the Temple of Natural, all those people came together. And so unity comes in when we lead people in an initiative. And we say, we would like to have a conference. Would you like to join in? And they said yes. And there are other organizations who we invited, and they said no. So unity comes with action. For example, if Mahmood says, let's actually go work with Crop Walk, we are united in the cause leading it. But unity doesn't come necessarily where we sit down, we all look alike. Unity comes in where we build homes, fight hunger, stand up for immigrant rights. That's where unity comes in. So I think any cause that we as Muslims or as Christians or Jews, we can come forward, or even non-believers, right, can come forward, if the cause is that, we will get united, right? But the fact that we have diversity amongst us is a strength, not a weakness.
No, but the panel, I'm sorry, sir, but the panel members go first and we see if we have any time.
I totally agree with Jawad's response. I think that's why the whole focus is to, you know, get commonalities amongst us and identify the issues and bring all diverse people opinion who are lined up to what you are trying to accomplish. So, you know, we can look at, theoretical discussions about all these organizations doing different things and how do we work together. My approach, my suggestion, like Jawad has suggested, is you pick up a cause, you identify the commonalities against which we all can make a difference, and then drive towards the betterment of humanity.
Thank you. This,
I was just going to say, we have a kind of a, since many of us are actually hopeful that we can actually move the needle on some of these issues, we have a new institutional structure at Seattle University that I hope will actually address some of what you're talking about through focusing on specific issues. So Jawad was in on the early stages of this, which began about 6.5 years ago, but we just founded a new center called the Center for Religious Wisdom and World Affairs. And what we're gonna do, every 2.5 to 3 years, we're gonna pick an issue that's creating a lot of human suffering. We're gonna bring interfaith scholars together, and we're gonna have an outreach to congregations, and the scholars will answer three questions. What does my tradition say about this issue? What is my tradition practically doing about it? And how has my tradition been hijacked, misunderstood, somehow misaligned with the particular issue to create confusion about what we think and what we're actually doing? And our hope is precisely this, that we build unity through focusing on a common problem that we all share from our religious heritages. And then we'll work out our differences as we go through. And we want to, and because we're a university, we want to get into the differences. That's part of what we do. But we want to get into it against a backdrop of actually moving forward on trying to relieve human misery in the world.
So all right, Dean, that's very helpful. And as it should be, one of our distinguished females on the panel will get the last word, and that's Varisha. Go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think I definitely want to go off of what Mark said, which is that, you know, we definitely need to, you know, go forward as individuals and, you know, in this room as coming from different backgrounds, you know, the different organizations that we serve, write a letter to the editor. So important. I think we've all identified the common problems here, especially when it comes to, you know, the hate speech that we've seen and the news coverage that we've talked about earlier, how that's impacted, you know, leading this, creating this climate that we live in of hate crimes and such. Please, 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 I implore you to write a letter to an editor. letters@seattletimes.com. Just shoot an email. Your words are actually quite powerful, and you yourself can have that impact in media the way that we wish that media would like to be.
So. And you don't have to limit that to the Seattle Times.
Of course not.
Any public media. First, we have a bit of a break now, followed by a movie, but I really want to thank the audience for their very fine following of this and the good questions. And our panelists, I have admiration for your candor, your convictions, your contents. Thank you very much.
Thank you.